Ladies and gentlemen, if you could now enter the hall, we will begin our conference. Please come inside the hall and take your seats. Thank you very much for your cooperation. Your Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning and welcome to the 2023 Ministry of Economy and Finance, Bank of Korea Financial Services Commission, and the International Monetary Fund International Conference. Allow me to introduce myself. My name is Ju Yan Cho, and I'm the conference interpreter, and I will be your facilitator over the course of the next 2 days. Thank you very much for your attendance. Thank you very much. It is indeed an honor to host and to be the facilitator of this conference, attended by such prestigious delegates representing their countries and organizations. The conference, as you have seen from our title, is co-organized by four institutions: the Ministry of Economy and Finance of the Republic of Korea, the Bank of Korea, the Financial Services Commission of the Republic of Korea, and the International Monetary Fund. And it is being held over the course of the next 2 days under the theme of digital money, navigating a changing financial landscape. I believe that it is a befitting theme for the times. The conference will provide a forum bringing together experts around the globe to discuss opportunities and challenges posed by digital money with distinguished policymakers, academics, and market participants. And expert panel discussions will cover crucial topics such as implications of digital money for the global economy, crypto regulation, developments in central bank digital currency, among others. And without further ado, let us begin the 2023 MOEF-BOK-FSC-IMF International Conference. Now, before our main session begins in earnest, I would like to introduce two of our organizers. Dr. Taehyung Cho, the Director of the Economic Research Institute at the Bank of Korea, and Mr. Harald Finger, the Assistant Director of the Asia-Pacific Division of the International Monetary Fund, will each deliver the organizers' welcome messages. Then first, let us welcome Mr. Cho with a hearty round of applause.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to express my sincere gratitude to you all for your participating in this conference on digital money and digital assets today and tomorrow. This conference has been a year and a half in the making, and it is a valuable intellectual forum that has been organized by the Ministry of Economy and Finance of the Republic of Korea and Bank of Korea and the Financial Services Commission in collaboration with the International Monetary Fund. I would like to thank all the organizers for their cooperation in making this conference happen. And I hope that you will share in the joy of mission accomplishment. On a personal note, we organized a conference with the IMF in September 2017. And this is my second time, so I'm even more honored to be here today. Under the theme of digital money navigating the changing financial landscape, this conference will discuss in depth the economic impact of and prospect of digital money, the direction of crypto asset, and the role of central banks and the relationship between CBDCs and then stable coins. In particular, it will be a valuable opportunity to hear about the current status and future direction of each issue through library panel discussions by top experts in the field, as well as to hear about Korea's position and challenges in this field. I hope that this conference will encourage Korea to work closely with international monetary community and the IMF, and I hope that the digitalization of the financial sector will progress in a way that benefits more people. We have a packed schedule for the next 2 days, but I hope you will take some time to explore the streets of Seoul, where the old and the new get together, and experience the flavors of Korean cuisine and the weather. Sorry about the somewhat rainy weather, but anyway, you feel the early season of the winter. Once again, thank you for joining us at this conference. I hope you will spend the next 2 days forging memories that will last a long time. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. CHOO, for your opening remarks. And ladies and gentlemen from overseas, in Korea we have a saying, whenever we move or we start a new operation, and if it rains on that day, we say that it's going to be a success. And I believe that rain is forecast for the next 2 days. So I believe that our conference will be a resounding success thanks to our guests from overseas. So thank you. Thank you very much. And now I would like to also invite to the stage Mr. Finger for his welcome remarks. Please welcome him with a big round of applause.
Dear Deputy Prime Minister CHOO, dear Vice Chairman Kim of the Financial Services Commission, dear Madam Managing Director GEORGIEVA of the International Monetary Fund, dear distinguished guests, dear conference participants from Korea, the Asia-Pacific region, and beyond, dear viewers on Bloomberg and on the viewers on online live streaming. So on behalf of the conference organizers from the Korean Ministry of Economy and Finance, the Bank of Korea, whose Governor Ri will be with us tomorrow, the Financial Services Commission and the IMF, I would like to welcome you to 2 exciting days of peer learning and exchange on the topics of digital money and digital assets. I'd like to extend my heartfelt gratitude to our co-organizers for their very close engagement throughout, and to the Ministry of Economy and Finance and the Bank of Korea in particular for their generous financial support. We are embarking on a 2-day program, which I think will be enriching and thought-provoking and full of dialogues among experts at the forefront of the various aspects of the fast-evolving topic of digital money. We have designed the program to facilitate meaningful exchanges among policymakers from Asia and across the globe. And this reflects our shared commitment to fostering international cooperation and a mutual understanding. So in this spirit, I would like to encourage all participants to seize the opportunity to interact and exchange ideas with their peers from other countries. In the rapidly evolving field of digital money and digital assets, these kinds of interactions can be a great catalyst, helping us to learn from each other, explore new solutions, and pave the way for collective progress. The IMF has been deeply involved in exploring practical aspects of digital money, from analyzing its impact on the global economy to addressing regulatory issues. We have been committed to delivering evidence-based insights in a very close collaboration with our member countries and our international partners, such as the standard-setting bodies. Just last week, we had the opportunity to release a fintech note exploring the macro-financial implications of crypto assets and I would encourage you all to take a look. We will, of course, continue to contribute to the discourse and understanding of these critical topics. So on behalf of the conference organizers, I look forward to the wealth of knowledge that will be shared over the next 2 days. And once again, thank you all for being here, and I wish you all a great 2 days ahead. Thank you. Gamsamnida.
Thank you once again, Mr. Harald Finger, for your welcome message, and of course, your organization of the next 2 days. I believe that it will be a fun-packed 2 days. Thank you very much. And now, ladies and gentlemen, it is my great privilege and joy to introduce our next speaker. It is going to be our Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Economy and Finance, His Excellency, Mr. Kyungho Choo. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome him with a big round of applause.
I'm Kyungho Choo, the Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Economy and Finance. Firstly, I extend my sincere gratitude to IMF Managing Director GEORGIEVA and her team, as well as to the officials from the Finance Service Commissions and the Bank of Korea. Their dedication has been instrumental in organizing this conference, a collaborative effort between the Korean government and the IMF, and the first since 2017. I also wish to express our deepest appreciation to Neil Eshoo, Secretary General of the Basel Committee, Global CEO Wodipka Swift, and other esteemed experts from home and abroad. And a warm welcome to those joining us online as well. The current international monetary system, which is primarily based on the fiat money underpinned by a nation's issuing authorities, has been a cornerstone of the remarkable growth of the world's economy since the mid-20th century. The state-managed of fiat money has the advantage in securing reliability and stability of the system, crucial for confidence in transaction and effective financial and monetary policy implementation. Yet, in our digital era, we encounter novel player to the system, private sector issued digital money. They include crypto asset and stable coins rooted in groundbreaking technologies like blockchain. Policymakers are still contemplating how to deal with the digital money in today's financial landscape. There is clear recognition of their potential to fill the gap of our current finance and monetary system. Yet, at the same time, they also have potential to bring certain risks to the financial stability. The global crisis response mechanism that have been refined over time through financial crisis might be compromised. The most significant benefit of digital money is that combined with innovative technologies, it can facilitate rapid settlement and clearing, immensely enhancing payment system efficiency. We anticipate breakthroughs enabling swift and cost-effective overseas remittances, transforming several-day processes into mere minutes. Additionally, digital money has the potential to make financial services more accessible and inclusive. Through user-friendly mobile apps, it can reach people who have been underserved by traditional financial systems. First and foremost, it can capitalize fintech industry growth. as evidenced by recent developments in tokenized securities. Digital money might open new markets, foster economic growth, and create jobs. However, digital money, particularly those based on private platforms, would frequently raise issues with reliability and stability. The Terra Luna incident from the previous year served as a clear reminder of these vulnerabilities. A widespread adoption of private digital money could undermine the effectiveness of monetary policies and make our economies more vulnerable to financial crises. In addition, these digital currencies are increasingly being used for illegal financial activities worldwide, making it more challenging for governments to tackle money laundering and other illicit transactions. Despite the challenges we face, it is clear that transition to digital money is already happening and it is unstoppable. Our goal is to establish a set of policy tools that not only support economic growth and financial innovation, but also ensure the reliability and stability. First, we need to stay nimble to customize our policies and institutions to keep up with digital innovations. By actively communicating with this fast-moving industry, we need to quickly embrace important policy needs, such as safeguarding users of digital money. Secondly, we should focus on solutions to build public trust and stability on top of the convenience and efficiency provided by digital money. Discussions around central bank digital currencies are good examples of such efforts. Finally, setting up global standards through close collaboration with governments and international bodies is essential, especially considering that digital money knows no borders. Against this background, initiatives like the IMF's recent CBDC book and the projects led by the BIS with the central banks are great examples of moving in the right directions. We may be at the entrance of next phase of the international monetary system, an era of uncertainties in digital currency. Aligning with IMF's managing director's thoughtful advice to think a little more like entrepreneurs, we must adopt an innovative approach in developing policies and systems relevant to digital money. This conference, which gathers insights from both the private and public sector, is crucial in devising a currency framework suitable for the digital age. I extend my profound gratitude to all participants for taking time out of your busy schedule to make such an invaluable contribution. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Deputy Prime Minister CHOO, for your welcoming speech, and thank you for your leadership and your insight. Thank you very much. And next, ladies and gentlemen, we also have another welcoming speech from our co-organizers. We will now invite our Vice Chairman of the Financial Services Commission, the Honorable Mr. Soyoung Kim, for his welcome speech. Please welcome him with a warm round of applause.
Good morning. I'm Soyoung Kim from Vice Chairman. I'm Soyoung Kim, Vice Chairman of the FSC of Korea. Under the theme of navigating a changing financial landscape, I'd like to extend a warm welcome to all of you participating in this digital asset conference co-hosted by Korean authorities and the IMF. Let me begin by thanking Ms. Kristalina GEORGIEVA, the Managing Director of the IMF, for taking your time to join us. I also would like to recognize Mr. Kyungho CHOO, Deputy Prime Minister of Korea. I'm so grateful to the IMF Secretariat and the Korean authorities, like Bank of Korea, Ministry of Economy and Finance, and FSC, for their valuable contribution to the success of this event. And my special thanks goes to experts who will participate in discussions. Near the end of 2023, it is all the more meaningful to have in-depth discussions with people from various fields, particularly on digital assets and CBDC. Our lives are rapidly changing due to digital transformation. Currencies for payment and settlement are now used in the form of digital money. They are used in electronic forms rather than in physical forms. Since 2009, blockchain technology and virtual assets such as Bitcoin has emerged. Blockchain has been considered as a revolutionary technology that might overcome the limits of the traditional financial system. In addition, through the decentralized financial system, the efficiency and transparency of transactions can be enhanced. Based on these possibilities as a future currency and asset, crypto asset market has expanded significantly. Nowadays, there are thousands of crypto assets with a market capitalization of approximately $1.7 trillion. However, as there are diverse types of virtual assets, various side effects are also rising. Due to the technical features of anonymity and decentralization, crypto assets have been used as a means for various illegal activities, such as terrorism, drugs, and gambling. The Terra Luna case led to the investment damage of more than $40 billion, and the bankruptcy of FTX, the world's third largest virtual asset exchange, greatly eroded trust in the crypto asset market. Various crypto asset scams and unfair trading activities are also continuing to damage investors. In addition, if crypto assets replace money and deposits, a decrease in bank deposits may cause a weakening of intermediation by banks. The link between virtual assets and financial markets is also strengthening. When a coin run occurs in the crypto asset market, banks with the crypto deposits are likely to be affected. When SVB collapsed in March this year, it resulted in a sharp depreciation of the stable coin, which deposited reserves at SVB. Against this backdrop, governments are facing an unprecedented challenge. They need to prepare for new risks proposed by digital assets, which have a different concept and system from the existing one. The origin of virtual assets and the whereabouts of producers are still difficult to know. In addition, due to the nature of cross-border transactions, the application of regulations by individual countries alone is not enough. Innovative and smart regulatory system design, coordination by each jurisdiction, and international cooperation are becoming increasingly important. Decentralization and anonymity should no longer be used as a cover for illegality and tax evasion. Major global countries are preparing for the possibility that distributed ledgers and blockchain technology will be used in the financial sector. At the same time, they are operating a regulatory system to protect users and stabilize financial markets. In the EU, markets in crypto asset, MiCA, is expected to be implemented among member states from the second half of 2024. MiCA stipulates obligations for virtual asset service providers, including disclosure requirements and customers' asset protection. In addition, insider trading and market manipulation are prohibited. Market regulations will be enforced, which stipulate the investigative and supervisory power among authorities. The United States strictly regulates relevant entities in the virtual asset market under the existing Securities Act and Commodity Exchange Act. According to executive order on the responsible development of virtual assets issued in 2022, the U.S. laid out its policy direction with regard to consumer protection and financial instability. In particular, international organizations like the FSB, BCBS, IOSCO, FATF, and the IMF are working closely together. They have recommended international standards, mainly focusing on the linkages between virtual assets and global financial markets. Their work goes on based on the principle of same activity, same risk, and same regulation. They emphasize the establishment of new regulatory frameworks for macroeconomic stability, financial stability, and consumer protection. And risk management, cross-border cooperation, and information sharing are also highlighted. The implementation series of member countries will also be reviewed. Then Korean government has continued to improve its regulatory system in line with global standards. In 2017, the number of investors and consumers in Korea increased dramatically following the global ICO boom. When the market was overheated with daily trading volume approaching $7.7 billion, the government initiated measures to block the link between crypto asset markets and the financial market and to strengthen risk management. In 2020, Act on Reporting and Using Specified Financial Transaction Information was amended to comply with the FATF's international standards to prevent money laundering using virtual assets. It stipulates anti-money laundering obligations for virtual asset services providers and financial institutions. However, unfair trading practices and various frauds in the crypto market have continued to damage users. In 2022, In the wake of the Terra Luna crisis and the FTX bankruptcy, some domestic service providers went bankrupt and deposit withdrawals was suspended. Under these circumstances, the need for user protection in the virtual asset market was rightly emphasized. The Virtual Asset User Protection Act was enacted and will be enforced from July next year. It forces service providers to take various measures to protect users, while various unfair trade practices will be prohibited at a similar level to the capital market. Unlike virtual assets, discussions on improving the current situation for tokenized securities are underway in the National Assembly to apply disciplines set out in the existing Capital Market Act. With this overall regulatory framework in place, we will further review the issuance and distribution of virtual assets, as well as service providers' operation activities and market regulation. These system supplements will reflect in additional legislation based on global regulatory trends and discussions. We will share the results and implications of the implementation of the Virtual Asset Act by participating in various global discussions. In parallel, we will actively cooperate and strive to strengthen international coordination and have integrity in the regulatory system. Amid the big wave of the fourth industrial revolution and digital transformation, the year 2024 will be a moment the systematic regulation of digital assets will commence in earnest. Now, opportunities and limitations of digital assets are being discussed together. The direction and strength of regulation will be a hinge factor that will determine the direction of future finance. For new regulations and innovation to work as a positive hinge, we should establish the institutional foundation where users are well protected and digital asset market bring a responsible growth. It is equally important to work with international organizations and global players to ensure consistency with international regulatory framework. We hope today's conference will serve as a venue for the industry authorities and international organizations to gain a broader understanding of their respective goals and directions. This in turn will help create a healthier digital asset ecosystem. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Vice Chairman Kim, for your kind remarks, sparing your wisdom, and thank you very much for your support from the Financial Services Commission. Thank you very much. And now, ladies and gentlemen, I am very much excited, honored, and grateful to be introducing our next speaker to you, as she is one respectable leader and also an inspiration for us all. She's also traveled far and wide to be here with us today. I believe that it is her first time in Korea as her role in the International Monetary Fund. So with that, I'm very much looking forward to her opening speech. Let us invite Dr. Kristalina GEORGIEVA, the Managing Director of the International Monetary Fund, for her opening speech. Please welcome her with a resounding round of applause.
Annyeonghaseyo. I have been looking forward to visiting Korea for quite some time. And I'm so delighted that it happens when I can take part in the discussions of this conference. My deepest gratitude to Deputy Prime Minister CHOO, to Deputy Vice Chair Kim, and to my dear friend, Governor Ri, with whom I have worked very closely when he was with us at the IMF. In old times, when guests would come from distant lands, they would huddle around a roaring fire and they would tell a story. And allow me to do the same today. Tell a story. It is a story of past, future, and present. It is a story of innovators and lawbreakers. It is a story of risks and opportunities. It is the story of crypto and blockchain. We begin with the recent past. It feels like the dusty Wild West of American history. Most crypto assets arrived on the scene unbacked or poorly backed, lacking intrinsic value and suffering from price volatility. Some of them, as we heard from the previous speakers, collapsed because of reliance on shaky reserves. Crypto assets were really risky assets. Many households have the scars to prove it. They lost money, a lot of it. The Wild West was a tough place with few sheriffs around and limited legislation and regulation. Criminals dominated. Money laundering and other illicit activity has been estimated to cost tens of billions of dollars per year. Just last month, the founder of the largest crypto exchange of Binance was taken to court, and he pleaded guilty to charges of money laundering. Right after the founder of FTX, a prominent exchange that crashed, was convicted of fraud and other crimes. Put it simply, in the last 15 years, the crypto industry has not built a glorious reputation, nor it is out of the woods. That takes us to look into the future. We must consider the effects if crypto assets become widespread. The scenario is not far-fetched. They may. For one, they are certainly not going away. Bitcoin now is trading at its highest value since April 2022. The crypto market cap doubled over the last year. And still today, people search for the word Bitcoin about 20 times more than health and wellness, and 7 times more than climate change. Also, crypto asset adoption is high, especially in emerging market economies, in India, Nigeria, Vietnam, and according to chain analysis, although data is scarce, we are seeing that advancement quite fast. In Brazil, our ongoing research shows every 100 real spent on foreign security has 25 reals going to crypto assets. So we have a rising tide. The challenge is that high crypto asset adoption could undermine macro-financial stability, certainly a challenge we care very deeply about at the IMF and with our members. For one, as our recent paper shows, cryptoization, the use of crypto assets instead of domestic currency, can undermine monetary policy transmission. What uses to raise interest rates on a currency few people use? In addition, capital flow management measures, such as limits on foreign currency holdings, could be circumvented in this world of digital dominance. And crypto could undermine fiscal sustainability if tax collection becomes volatile or more difficult to enforce. And this is a future we do not want to go into. to figure out how we can minimize the risks, let's return to the present and go from Wild West to East Asia to learn from the rich traditions of Korea. I am inspired, Deputy Prime Minister, by Hangul. For my fellow visitors, those of us who came from faraway lands, this is the writing system of the Korean language that was introduced in the 15th century by King Sejong. Its simple structure replaced an inefficient writing system that was only accessible to the elite. From ancient scripts to smartphones, Hangul has proven incredibly adaptable. And it is beautiful. You can, I'm sure the Koreans in the audience would agree with that. Hangul is the perfect public good with clear rules of constructing syllables and words to minimal yet very solid infrastructure, an alphabet of 24 letters. This is similar to what we are trying to accomplish today. Our goal is to make a more efficient, interoperable, and accessible financial system by providing rules to avoid the risks of crypto and infrastructure by leveraging some of the technologies. And let's look at each of those. After an enlightening discussion with our member countries, the IMF and the Financial Stability Board published a report last September offering guidance on the rules for crypto assets. Among the main elements, do not make crypto assets legal tender or official currencies. Clarify and consistently apply laws, standards, and regulations, including for anti-money laundering and financial terrorism. Establish clear tax rules. Provide a solid legal foundation with a clear classification of crypto assets. And coordinate policies globally to avoid regulatory arbitrage, since crypto asset providers can relocate at the click of a button. Countries are implementing this guidance, turning it into legislation, training supervisors and overseers, and enforcing compliance. Korea, for instance, is showing leadership by amending its anti-money laundering law. We heard some of the legislative changes that are being introduced just now, and setting up a new legislation on crypto assets. Again, I want to thank both previous speakers for the information they have provided to us. We, together with the FSB, are helping members on all these fronts, and we stand ready to do more. These rules are not meant to return us to the pre-crypto world, nor to squash innovation. Neither is crypto all tainted by fraud. Like when we were in the Wild West, it was not only about crooks, it was also about creativity, development, expanding opportunities for all. Good rules can spur and guide innovation. For instance, banks are exploring new trading infrastructure using blockchain technology refined and popularized by the crypto boom. It is now so very well known to us, and it wasn't a couple of years before. They hope to cut costs and boost speed, so trillions of dollars of daily asset transactions can happen, broadening financial access to those currently content with low-yielding deposit accounts. Today, banks create an asset in paper form, deposit it with a custodian, and message intermediaries so each may reconcile its version of who owns what. It works, but it is expensive. Instead, imagine establishing the asset as an entry or token on the blockchain and trading it by updating the blockchain. What are the potential gains? They're very large. The blockchain is accessible by all transacting parties. It is transparent, tamper-proof, and settlement is fast. It is instantaneous. Financial assets in token form can also be divided into parts to serve smaller investors. And transactions can be automated and bundled to occur simultaneously. This lowers the risk that counterparties or trades fail before an asset gets to its rightful owner. I saw this with my own eyes when last month in bank pilots under the Monetary Authority of Singapore, Project Guardian, the IMF was invited to be an observer. To be clear, many hurdles must still be overcome to go from pilots as Project Guardian to production, such as establishing legal frameworks. While we cannot predict adoption, we must be ready. Planning the right infrastructure is absolutely paramount. That's where the public sector comes in, to ensure that this infrastructure meets public policy objectives. The blockchain I just described would need to be cheap, stable, and trusted. It must ensure interoperability between assets and the contracts to trade them. They will also require safe money that is also on chain. And this safe money that we all now engage and talk about, central bank digital currencies, they can play a key role in integrating this new financial system. Compliance with international standards, such as anti-money laundering, will be absolutely key, as will consistency with countries' policy priorities. And I want to stress that we have been talking about this topic now for some time. It is the platforms I described at the Singapore FinTech Festival, those virtual town squares that facilitate transactions. I focused there on how platforms favor interoperability of currencies, while today we are discussing the interoperability of assets. After all, money is a financial contract. It is an IOU, just like any other asset. Whether we want to fix cross-border payments or ensure the efficiency and stability of asset transactions, we end up in the same place. Rules and infrastructures may well be the consonants and the vowels of tomorrow's international monetary system. They need to be as sensible and far-sighted as Hangul. I want to finish with the words of the great Korean philosopher and public servant, Yugok. He said, "If one practices with one's strength, one can reach efficiency and then obtain results." Let's do it. Kamsahamnida.
Thank you very much, Dr. Kristalina Georgieva, for the wonderful and enlightening speech. Once again, please give her a big round of applause. Thank you very much. Thank you for the story of the innovators and the lawbreakers. And also thank you for introducing our Hangul in your speech. And of course, our proud ancestors of King Sejong and Yulgok Ii. We are very proud of our ancestors, but it was great to hear them be spoken and to be recognized by our Dr. Georgieva. So thank you very much. And now, ladies and gentlemen, we will move on to our first panel discussion under the title of Digital Money and Its Role in the Global Economy, Opportunities and Challenges. Allow us to set the stage. We have five panelists and a moderator in our first discussion. And I will first introduce them to you one by one and then invite them all at once up onto the stage. So first and foremost, we are joined by Dr. Kristalina Georgieva, the Managing Director of the International Monetary Fund. We'll also be joined by Dr. Stefan Ingves, the former governor of the Sveriges Riksbank. And we'll also be joined by Mr. Soyoung Kim, the Vice Chairman of the Financial Services Commission. Also, Mr. David Rutter, the founder and CEO of R3. Mr. Hyun Song-shin, the economic advisor and head of research, the Bank for International Settlements. And our moderator, of course, Ms. Haslinda Amin, the anchor and chief international correspondent for Southeast Asia for Bloomberg Television. Please welcome them up on stage with a big round of applause. I believe our moderator and panelists are all seated and ready, so I hand the floor over to our moderator.
Good morning. Digital money provides a great opportunity for the financial system, the global financial system. It promises to be more inclusive, more efficient, seamless, and most central banks are exploring digital money, some already testing their own digital currencies. Several weeks ago in Singapore, Kristalina said that digital money can replace cash, and she is right. She's always right, by the way. But the problem is this. There are still big issues that need to be addressed. Interoperability, scalability. So how do you assess the opportunities and challenges of digital money? Kristalina, just let's start with you, right? We have China launching its digital yuan back in 2021. India launches Indian rupee last year. Singapore doing all sorts of tests to pave the way for the digital Sing dollar. Give us a sense of the compelling reasons for the digital currency.
Well, thank you very much. It is clear that the world of money is now moving faster towards digitalization. Before the pandemic, we used to say the future is digital. And with the pandemic, the future has arrived. Processes that were already in place are now moving much faster. Why is that? Well, there are three reasons. The first one is technology allows us to gradually move into transactions in which speed is many times higher. And that, of course, means the second reason, costs of transactions go down. And the third one is that with the advancements of technology, policymakers have found ways in which the risks of digital money can be addressed, and in the previous segment, we talked about it. So what we see today is a very diverse world of how countries are approaching digital money. In advanced economies, for example, the major issues, top of mind issues are, can we ensure that monetary policy sovereignty is retained? Can central banks play their role effectively in a world of digitalization? In emerging markets and developing economies, these are also top of mind concerns. But there, financial inclusion, as well as opportunity to leapfrog, not go through the, you know, bricks and mortar banks, but straight into the digital space, are also important concerns. What we see at the IMF is our membership comes to us more and more with demands for technical assistance in this area of digital money. And they usually come with first a request to help them understand the whole landscape. What is the difference between central bank digital currencies and crypto assets? Within the crypto assets, how could we go to a safer place? What is the difference between backed and unbacked? Can we think of crypto as money, or we have to only think of crypto as assets, some riskier than others? I think that it is fair to say all of us in this room have been galloping through our own learning on a topic that certainly is going to be with us, is going to impact the way we operate, where risks and opportunities are very, very real.
We know that more than 90% of central banks in the world are exploring digital money.
Yep.
In your conversations, what's the key issue for most of them?
The key issue for central banks is monetary policy sovereignty. How could they make sure that they can operate an economy where there is predictability? Second on their list comes interoperability. How can we make sure that the world remains connected, that as technology and policies so quickly change, we don't lead to a fragmentation in financial interactions? And the third issue, of course, is how to prevent people falling for basically scams. How to advance regulation without stifling innovation. And that's not an easy task. I also have had a number of very interesting conversations around CBDCs, wholesale and retail. And how do you make this choice? That is now for us at the IMF, the fastest growing area of demand for our engagement with other organizations, with FSB, with BIS, and for providing capacity development. And I want to recognize Korea. Korea is the sixth largest supporter of capacity development activities of the fund. And they are among those countries that say, in this area, we need the fund, because if we don't have an institution like the fund with 190 members, we do risk, you know, 1,000 flowers booming, but no bouquet.
Stefan, let's bring you into the conversation. You have a deep understanding and appreciation for the history of money and monetary policy. How are you looking at the evolution of money and finance right now?
Well, first of all, I think it's very important to be mindful of the fact that money is a convention. Mm. Money is about what we have in our heads. And that's what really matters. And money also has a very long history. And that we tend to forget when we talk about crypto, this and that, and people actually try to reinvent the wheel. Technologies change, and financial sector structures also change. And financial sector structures are different in different countries. And that raises the issue then, what do we do when technologies change, and how do we understand what these new technologies can do, and what is it that we really want them to do? And that's quite a difference. And then if history gives us any guidance, actually private money does not have a stellar record. And that is regardless of choice of technology.
Yep.
And that is really what is important. Unfortunately, in some cases, public sector money does not have a stellar record either.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not going to mention any countries, but all of you in this room know exactly what type of economies I'm talking about. But in this environment, still, someone has to set the rules. Someone has to determine deconvention. And here, actually, the state has the monopoly right to produce laws. And that ultimately means that it's up to the state to define what money is and to define what various technologies actually do in this setting. And the last time this happened, and this is why we're struggling with this topic today and why we have this conference, was basically in the late 1800s. Because back then, more than 100 years ago, everything was on paper, nothing was digital, and we had a great debate who should have the right to issue physical banknotes. And eventually, most central banks ended up with the sole right to do that, and private banks usually did not issue banknotes. And that was because of the bad experience that we had back then. Now, all of this comes back because technology changes. And then people all of a sudden have to struggle with issues that they have taken for granted, that they have not had to deal with for 100 or 150 years. And they find that very puzzling. And many, many people think that they have invented something new when it is actually not new at all. It's just sort of the same old story. What's the convention? How do we define money? And if you talk about CBDC, it doesn't really matter so much if it's wholesale, retail, you just need it in order to anchor your unit of account. And if the exchange rate between public sector money and private sector money is not one-to-one, then you don't know what money is anymore in your particular economy. And that's why it's so important for central banks and central bankers to struggle through this issue of how do we deal with CBDCs in this new environment. At the same time, and here I'm using a phrase that a colleague of mine came up with a few years ago, I do think that what I call the fiat money team, central banks and legacy banks have been too slow. And that's because in many, many cases, legacy banks run age-old IT systems, and many banking sectors are way, way too oligopolistic. And they just don't want to move because it costs money to create new money. And that has created an environment when all of a sudden all these other guys show up out of the blue and try to replace the banks. And that creates an element of confusion. And that means that today when we talk about money, we should actually maybe use the plural monies. And because at one end of the spectrum, we have basically CBDCs. Then we have what we call stable coins. Sometimes I actually call them unstable coins. I think that's a much better phrase. And then we have various coins with no backing at all. And that means that we have a full spectrum of stuff that people call money, but most of it is not really money at all.
Yep.
And that's really a key when it comes to thinking about these things. And what matters here is that it's up to the fiat money team to create what I call transactional efficiency. Because if you're unable to engineer transactional efficiency, basically consumers and investors will use somebody else's money. And then you are out of it, and then you cannot really do monetary policy anymore the way we think about monetary policy. So that's why it's so important not to be asleep at the wheel. And that this is a challenge today. And one more challenge in this among many is I think a fact, and that is that those who know a lot about money do not know a lot about IT systems.
And those who know a lot about IT systems
don't know much.
They know almost nothing about money. And that's why this is so challenging.
Stefan, I just want to follow up. You said there's no difference between wholesale and retail CBDCs, yet some central banks are reluctant to issue retail CBDCs. I mean, take us through the thinking and why not?
Ultimately, it's a political value judgment. Because essentially, if you do not issue a retail CBDC, you make it impossible for the general public to hold central bank money. And I think that that's a very bad idea, because then essentially you have privatized money. And that has a bad record. We tried that in the Swedish economy in the late 1700s, because the central bank refused to lend to the king. The king got so upset, so he started the National Debt Office, and the debt office started issuing its own money, and there was an immediate devaluation of about at least 50%. Mm-hmm. And that means that if central banks refuse to do this, somebody else is just gonna do it for them in one way or the other. Yeah. But again, economists will never come to this conclusion by just doing five more equations. Mm. Because it takes political value judgments to reach that conclusion.
David, we can't talk about digital money without talking about blockchain. That is essentially the technology backing it. Talk to us about the potential of blockchain in financial services.
Sure, I challenge one thing. I'm not sure blockchain is essential for digital money, even though I come from that. I think what blockchain did was got us all to think differently about how we did things. Importantly, to give you my perspective, and this isn't a sales pitch, but I've had 40 years in Wall Street in various roles, and I've owned broker-dealers. I'm a registered securities rep. And I was really inspired by Bitcoin, and I thought, wow, this technology can do things we haven't been able to do in the past. It can solve the trust problem. What I see is what you see. It can be appended but not amended. It can be permission-based so that only actors that have the right to do certain things can do certain things, so we can get rid of reconciliation. We can use advanced cryptology in distributed ways to have higher security. So it opened up a whole plethora of opportunities that have actually taken longer to take hold than I thought. I've been at this for 8 years now. But from my perspective, financial markets fundamentally work. They're imperfect in many, many ways. And I looked at this technology as a way to improve upon that. And we're beginning to see some real, you know, production-based systems. The SDX issues digital bonds that are truly digitally native. And you can settle them now with wholesale CBDC from the Swiss National Bank. You have creative firms like HQLAX, which tokenize underlying collateral for collateral swaps and balance sheet management. The Italian banking system runs on our product, Corda. You know, we've made decisions around a private permission ledger because we always felt that the regulatory regime as it exists today fundamentally works. It's developed over 100 years and it can be applied to this new technology. From the private sector, I can speak a little more bluntly probably in some ways. The public sector gives maybe more credence to crypto than I ever would by talking about it as an asset when fundamentally, it's not the vast majority. Almost all crypto coins that have been issued have been fundamentally about issuing a white paper and founders taking money off of the table. We've heard many speakers today talk about the nefarious usage of crypto. Calling them assets is concerning. And also, you know, I can't tell you how many painters at my house or valets or folks that have come into contact, and they Google you, and they think blockchain is crypto. And actually, Corda is a distributed ledger technology. We don't use blocks. That's inefficient for regulated finance, so we're not going to actually have blockchains underpinning our financial infrastructure. And you know, they express how, hey, I have half of my retirement savings in a combination of XRP, Dogecoin, and God knows whatever coin. So it's been really concerning for me, and I think that the regulators have been a bit slow to address it. Now, with any new technology innovation like the internet, there's amazing potential for us to reinvent money, and we're doing a lot of work there with Project Jura and Project Dunbar, and we mentioned a project out of Singapore a little bit earlier. And we can see clear paths to improve international payments, domestic payments, purpose-bound money for social good. There's a lot of good stuff that can come out of this, but as a community, we have to be very aware of the dark side, and I think those things can be addressed more forcefully. And I don't consider crypto money. And just one other thing is I'm not going to claim to be the greenest person in the world, but the fact that Bitcoin, when I last checked, consumed more energy than the country of New Zealand, and we can all go crazy about what's happening at a COP and then just ignore that this thing exists that burns that kind of energy and is used for nefarious means, as we know, primarily, in my opinion. We shouldn't ignore those things.
Stefan talked about how those who know money don't know anything about technology. So for policymakers, what are the key considerations when you think about blockchain and technology for digital money?
So there's all sorts of monetary considerations, monetary policy considerations, which is beyond my expertise, and that's up to you all in this room to solve. But you end up with natural effects like the increasing velocity of money, but you end up with all the benefits for commerce, where you can link a delivery of goods to instant payments. That's very important in developing economies with small companies where cash is king. It's all about cash flow. So you can do so many new things. And certain institutions like SWIFT, and I don't have a view here, come into question. CLS, definitely. Why do you don't have hairstat risk when you can atomically lock a payment and an asset on a single level ledger. So there's no need for some of these institutions. So I see a very, very bright future. I would just encourage, there's a lot going on, and for the central bankers in this room, there's plenty of SIs that would charge you a ton to reinvent the wheel. There's been dozens, if not hundreds, of experiments done. There's live implementations already, and there's ways you can learn very quickly and come up to speed on what the technology can do for your country and your money.
So regulators don't necessarily have to play catch up all the time. They're laggards, essentially, most of the time.
Yeah, and I think the good news for regulators is there's fundamentally sound principles around consumer protection and the way institutional finance is regulated today. So as a 724 and 63, the fundamental concept behind institutional finance regulation is I have a firm that I can hold responsible for activities on a platform, whether it's a stock exchange, a derivatives exchange, an FX exchange, or fixed income exchanges. Two of those four I've run before. And if the firm doesn't behave in a way that's appropriate, I can go after the individuals. Well, that makes you really pay attention to how you treat your customers. And if it came to anyone as a surprise, I mean, I've gotten a lot of flack because I've said in my 40 years, I've seen fraud, I've seen Ponzi schemes, and I've seen bubbles. But crypto was the first fraudulent Ponzi scheme bubble I saw wrapped up in one. So if anyone was surprised at Sam Bankman-Fried's outcome or CZ or whatever, we smell the coffee here, and that's just exactly the same regulations to those actors that we do for folks that run traditional exchanges.
Soyoung, so much skepticism and criticism from this panel. When it comes to cryptocurrencies, I mean, Korea has a very active crypto market. I think it's valued at about $21 billion or so. What kind of policies can ensure the safety of the consumers and perhaps safeguard the financial system?
So first, Korea has a highly digitized financial sector. In Korea, 78% of banking transactions are done digitally, and 93% of balance inquiry services are done by internet banking. And Korea is also very much interested in crypto asset. Recently, Bloomberg reported for crypto asset transactions in this November, Korean was used even more than the US dollar. However, crypto assets are still mostly utilized for simple investment purposes rather than for more useful purposes, for example, transaction cost reduction, efficient cross-border payments, or financial inclusions. Then for government regulation of crypto asset markets, I think the top priority is user protection and anti-money laundering. This is because if many people suffer from the crypto asset transactions or crypto assets are used as a means of crime, then we cannot really advocate for crypto asset transactions. So this is exactly what we are doing in Korea. In July next year, the Crypto Assets User Protection Act will take effect in Korea. The act establishes a regulatory system for user protection based on the principle of same function, same risk, and same regulation. Unfair transactions like market manipulation will also be strongly punished. And we have already introduced a reporting system for crypto asset service providers to comply with the standard set by the FATF. So this is for anti-money laundering. Then we plan to further develop regulations on other areas like tokenized securities, some business conduct in relation to, for example, issuance or distribution and so on. So we will go on step by step.
Step by step, is there a risk of over-regulating the sector? Because there's always that fine balance between regulation and innovation. How are you looking at it?
So up to now, we haven't really over-regulated the only, as I said.
Is there a risk of that happening? Is there a risk that you would impinge on innovation?
Yes, so up to now we only have the law for user protection and anti-money laundering. So I think that, as you said, innovation in this sector is very important. So we'll consider them more in the next stage of the regulation. So when we have to regulate or we have to set up the regulations on the issuance and trade and the distribution. So I think that's exactly the area that we have to look at. We have to be in balance with protection and innovation.
Tokenization, Hyung Song, how will that influence and shape the financial system?
I think tokenized securities can help a lot on by introducing new securities and new type of securities, and I think that tokenized security is one of the most important areas that really go for innovation,
right,
compared to other virtual assets. Other virtual assets doesn't have any intrinsic value. So, on the other hand, tokenized securities has that's make a securities that has intrinsic value. So I think the most innovations will be mostly from tokenized securities.
Kyung-sung? Mm-hmm.
Well, I think, first of all, let me thank the IMF and the Korean authorities for laying on this very timely event. And it's a tremendous set of topics that we're discussing. On tokenization, I would start with what Stefan said. We have to look to history and see how technology has really kept pace with economic development. And the development of the monetary system over history has really given rise to tremendous leaps in economic activity and growth. And digitalization, which is 50, 60 years old, without that, we would not be here today. Tokenization is digitalization plus a very important element, which is the rules and logic governing the transfers. Now, I didn't say blockchain, I didn't say decentralization, because I think the technology is secondary. The principle is we have the rules and the logic that are combined with the digital representation of the money or assets. Now, why this is important is because the nature of the financial system, the nature of the economic transactions, has to do with a very dense web of contracts. So I do something in the expectation that you will do something. The simplest form is I pay, you deliver. And what tokenization does is to combine the payment and the delivery. And so there's no risk that I pay, but I don't get the money, I don't get the goods, or vice versa. So what do you need for this? Well, I think David put it very well. You don't need blockchain. You know, you could use blockchain, but you don't need it. What you need is for money and the digital assets to be in the same venue so that you can apply the same program to both. And I think securities, digital security, financial securities is probably the lowest hanging fruit. But I think what this does show is the limits to using blockchain, especially the public blockchain. Because suppose that I want to buy a real world asset, let's say a security. I have to be sure that whatever the digital representation there is on the platform actually gives me legal ownership of the underlying security. Now, for that, you do need the legal framework to actually mm-hmm. back it up. And this is why crypto, which was designed to circumvent the legal framework, is not the right approach. And I think we've heard plenty from the managing director today and the other speakers on why crypto is not the right way forward. Instead, what you need is much more of the public infrastructure perspective, which is money is a public infrastructure. And what you need to do is to have a way of putting assets and money on the same platform. Central bank digital currencies are absolutely essential because that is the settlement asset. But most of the transactions will be taking place using private money. And the BIS has advocated the use of tokenized deposits. Let me just mention, the project that the Korean authorities are conducting, very much with the Bank of Korea at the helm, which is on the project of having central bank digital currencies, tokenized deposits, commercial bank deposits, together with other digital assets that are interlinked and maybe which makes it programmable. So let me just stop there. And
I'm just wondering how this is all going to play out, because if you go with what McKinsey is suggesting, it says that $4 to $5 trillion of tokenized digital securities will be issued by 2030, but that's a conservative estimate. Mm-hmm. And others are suggesting that it wouldn't just be like your stocks and bonds, it's just going to go into your fine wine and art. How is this going to play out?
Absolutely. So I think, first of all, I think digital securities, financial securities, that's the lowest hanging fruit because that's already digitalized through the securities depository, the various centralized securities depositories. So we already have ways of transacting securities simply by adjusting a digital entry. I think the bigger goal will be to expand the set of assets that can be tokenized. And for the Korean audience today, I think a very, very good example would be the risks that we can overcome in the Jeonse market. So Jeonse, Haslinda, as you know, is a very special Korean type of housing contract where you hand over a large deposit to the landlord in return for sitting in the collateral asset, which is the house. So you're actually living in the collateral. But one thing that we've seen in the last year or so, last couple of years when house prices have fallen, is that sometimes the transactions were not very transparent. There were actually additional liens on the house, like a mortgage, which was not disclosed. And there are timing problems. Wouldn't it be nice if we could have a tokenized Jeonse contract where you can be assured that whenever I pay my deposit, I get a clean house back in return. And that's the power of tokenization. You can actually program these things in a very clean way.
My colleague, Emily, would appreciate that very much. She went through quite a bit of difficulty. Stefan, we talked about earlier how digital money allows for greater inclusion. But it is kind of problematic because when you think about technology, there's always that technological divide. How do you bridge that gap? How do you address the issue to ensure that everybody is on board?
It's going to happen one way or the other, because I come from an environment where basically you can forget about notes and coins. Mm-hmm. That's yesterday's technology. So it just happens, and you have to get used to that idea. But financial inclusion actually varies from country to country. and it varies quite a lot. And financial inclusion and new technologies go hand in hand and will be, I think, quite important in many, many smaller developing countries, because in those places, it's not all that unusual, actually, that the central bank is the only functioning institution that people trust. And in that environment, if the central bank chooses sensible technologies, then that will actually very much foster financial inclusion in one form or the other. And one way to think about it is that we're not really talking about bricks and mortar anymore. We're not talking about branch offices. We're essentially talking about how to recreate old-fashioned credit unions and savings banks the way they were structured in the mid-1800s, but only using digital technology to make that happen. And then you actually end up with a system which is better than branch offices and cash, because it's much more convenient to use. But some of the preconditions need to exist to make that happen. First of all, you have to have some kind of electricity in one form or the other. Otherwise, it doesn't work. You have to have cellular networks. It's very helpful if you're able at the national level to create a digital ID so that you can define who you are. And you need a sort of a public sector vision of how this is supposed to happen. Because without that vision, it's very, very difficult to give guidance to the private sector. But also, I hope it's music to the fun people in this room, you also need to have a reasonably stable macroeconomic environment. Because that really means that you have to fix the fiscal and don't print too much money. And nothing can save you from those two on the technology side. If you misbehave, you misbehave, and people actually migrate to somebody else's currency. So that's also part of the system. And here, the recently published IMF digital handbook, or whatever it's called, is a very nice document sort of giving elements of guidance when it comes to how you should actually go about doing this. I've read all this stuff, and there are always elements of sort of uneasiness in those documents as well. So you better make up your minds, actually, you guys on the fund side, what your opinions are when it comes to this. Because life is a risky business, and if you sit with your arms crossed forever, somebody else is just going to run it for you. So you have to choose a direction when it comes to doing this. And we already have examples. If you look at, for example, what has happened in India, and yep. how all of this has been implemented for hundreds of millions and millions of people, clearly there are good examples where you can show that this is actually doable with existing technologies. But having said that, you also need to understand how to supervise in the digital world. What does that really mean? What is a supervisor supposed to do in a completely digital world? And that is something that we have actually need to put more resources into that, because it's not obvious. And new technologies do not make old problems go away. I mean, this when it comes to money, if it's too good to be true, that is probably the case, and that's independent on whatever technology you have chosen. So. And I also do think that some of these investments will not be carried out by the private sector alone, because some of it is about returns to scale, some of it is about setting the rules, and particularly when it comes to financial inclusion, somebody actually has to invest in apps and systems that also people with disabilities can use. And there's not enough money on the private sector side to do that. And there are elements of consumer protection also that you need to be mindful of. So really what you need to do, and this sounds like an oxymoron, is you need to be a kind of a public sector entrepreneur to make this happen. And that's, of course, hard to do.
When it comes to financial inclusion, Kristalina, are you encouraged that digital money will achieve that? What are you seeing so far when in your conversations?
Well, the unquestionably, this is very welcomed by developing countries, that they can very quickly expand access to everyone. There are preconditions, and Stefan talked about them. One, you do need electricity, access to electricity. For fairness, you don't need access to electricity 24/7. We have seen this in remote areas in Africa. Sure. With 2 hours access to electricity, you charge your phone, you have an ability to function. Developing countries, emerging markets, they also see a tremendous opportunity to cut short their own movement by jumping over things that we have done and still do, like checkbooks do not exist in developing countries. You know, you show a checkbook and they say, what is this? We have seen enormous innovation like M-Pesa in Kenya that now spread all over Africa. And if you think about who are the sometimes determined obstacles, they come from business interests in the current infrastructure. If you are in the business of cross-border payments that allow you to take today the average cost of remittances is 6.3%. It's a very profitable business. The target in the Millennium Development Goals is 3%. With massive shift towards digitalization, that target can be reached and exceeded. So I think I am with Stefan. I think that this is happening. Policymakers either are part of it and help it to be done better, or it would be done anyway, and we would find ourselves wrestling with consequences of our own inaction. I want to finish with one point. What we have seen at the fund is a tremendous interest in learning from each other. And guess what? The biggest interest is learning from emerging markets that are ahead of the curve. India, their digital public infrastructure, the fact that there is digital ID for everyone, that put something in place that public and private can tap into and benefit from, of great interest to everybody in the emerging markets. M-Pesa, I mentioned, it took a courage to put it in place, and now everybody says in Africa this is the way to go. But does it mean that there is not a big role for advanced economies? No. Advanced economies bring two things. They have, by and large, most of them, very sound macro fundamentals. And they have learned through history the role of rule of law, to have trust without which none of what we talk about is going to really work. And secondly, advanced economies bring the experience they have had in their own history of money. And again, Stefan was right to say it is a very valuable experience, even if we now move to a different direction in the digital world.
Speaking of opportunities, David, I mean, we talk about cross-border. Where are the opportunities there?
Well, I think we just identified an exciting business opportunity for R3. I will be more than happy to deliver a global remittance system at 3%. Mm-hmm. So, and I won't start there, but the remittance is...
And you would make good money out of it.
Very, very good money. Very good money. I was going to start with the remittances, but we might as well. A number of the countries, we're doing a lot of work in the Gulf right now where there's a lot of migrant workers, and there's just so much optimism and there's so much going on in that region, and they genuinely are looking at their migrant workers and how they transfer money at home and what it costs. And you know, not only do you have savings, but in a programmable world, you can have directed payments. So it could come directly out of their salary. It could go back home. It could be purpose-bound money specifically for education and milk and nappies for the kids. And I think that, you know, some people, DeSantis in Florida and some others, think, oh, this is the great state taking charge. But, you know, everyone's allowed to have different perspectives. And this was my point earlier about how purpose-bound money can be used for good. From the business perspective, international payments are very, very clumsy. They're very slow. They're very expensive. And I have no visibility. And cash is the bloodline of every business, especially small businesses. And we want to encourage developing countries, smaller manufacturers. We want to creative startups. We want to make sure that they can thrive. So with cross-border payments, and we know this, we've done enough experimentation already, it's cheaper, it's more efficient. Mm-hmm. I have much more visibility as to my payments. Certain infrastructure that exists today, as I mentioned earlier, whether it be CLS or SWIFT, correspondent banking, all can be challenged under this. And you can come up with a much more creative solution. And importantly, because we talked about smart contracts on ledger, and it doesn't have to be just on one system, because there is a lot of work being done in interoperability now, but you don't want thousands. You know, you can actually enter, if I'm an exporter, I can enter a contract to sell a good or service based on payment terms that I understand and I accept at the time of sale. And that could be an IoT device like the UPS or FedEx guy scans the box. When it's delivered on the porch, it releases the payment. You know, those the type of certainty for young businesses in programmable money where delivery of your good is linked to the payment can be very, very valuable. And we've tested nearly all of this out. The other driver, let's face it, is the China and the Enbridge project. Certainly, there's a geopolitical aspect of that, which I you know, fully understand. It will allow countries to have more control over the international payments for themselves and for their business. There's often reasons why you know, they might want to support a given sector or open up a new trade avenue and the like. So there's just a lot more flexibility. It's cheaper, it's efficient, there's visibility. I can watch it on my smartphone. Mm-hmm. So there's a ton of benefits that we're
But how thinking. Do you expedite the process, Kyungho?
How do you know, expedite it? You know, we talked earlier, Stefan, you might have mentioned about the banking systems are on older technology. I mean, I hope I don't get in trouble for this, but you know, FMI is like DTCC and Euroclear and some of these other organizations, they still use COBOL. I mean, they hire engineers, they overpay them, and they put them into training classes because no one teaches COBOL anymore. That infrastructure has been hardened over decades, but it works, okay? And it protects consumers, it protects folks involved. So it's going to take a while, and importantly, it doesn't have to be a hard cutover. They will coexist, and my own view is that because of all the benefits I mentioned, once there's enough you know, CBDC in place with bilateral, multilateral trading connections, we will very quickly see folks move over to the new rails, but it will take time.
Yep. Cross-border platforms, how do they fit into the future international monetary system?
Well, this is very exciting for us because what we recognize is that there is now progress on multiple fronts. First, there is progress on the easy fixes. There is now understanding that for cross-border platforms to exist, we have to have common standards
And there has to be kind of common language so they can function well. This is fairly straightforward, and we see movement. Second, we see countries bilaterally and plurilaterally coming together. Singapore, Thailand, with BIS help. ASEAN 5 now saying, well, we want to move on this very quickly. In the Gulf, extremely fast moving. And when you have this plurilateral, bilateral, or plurilateral arrangements, what happens is they teach us how that can be expanded even faster. And then comes the tougher part, which is to create what I talked about here and in Singapore, this virtual public squares, platforms that are unifying for everyone. And that is going to take some time. But if you go in these multiple directions, each one of them builds the foundation for the next one, for getting to a point when platforms are there and cross-border payments are instantaneous, much cheaper, much more accessible to people who today have very little money and see a big chunk of it being taken away just to pass it from here to there. Can I ask the audience a question? I got very intrigued by that. My question is, how many of you have cash in your wallets? Can you raise your hand? People with cash. Okay. Yes, I actually also have some cash. How many have no cash whatsoever? So here we go. Because I see it and you don't see it, it seems to me more like one-third, two-third?
Yes.
Two-third with cash, one-third without. And it would be interesting a year from now to ask the same question and then a year from now to ask this question. And I think the direction to travel would be fewer and fewer with cash.
I had a conversation with Ravi Menon, and he says, have cash as backup.
Sorry? Oh, yeah. That's actually, this is actually true, that as you said, they would coexist. And it is very possible that having cash for at least years and years ahead would be necessary. But the question is not whether we have it. The question is whether we use it, whether we keep it in our pocket every day, or we have something stashed just in case. And I think we would move towards just in case. Of course, if we were to then ask demographics and see younger versus older, I think those of us from the older generation would be more inclined to have cash just in case.
David, you wanted to add something?
Yeah, I was just going to say, but you've already covered it, and no offense to the audience, but if you look at the average age of this group, if we had an average age of, say, 28 out here, it would be 95% carries no cash and 5% carries cash.
That's exactly it, yep.
Can I just add a comment to that? Because reading up on various reports coming to Korea, I read a report about transactions in the case of Sweden, and basically the view is that cash transactions, maybe 1% in the future, not more than that. And in addition to that, and this has something to do with age, if you talk to young people, they're actually more comfortable using apps than cash. Mm-hmm. And they feel insecure when they pay using cash because they don't know how to do it. so cash is really for grandma and grandpa in the future. And also, when it comes to making payments using cash, it's a logistical system. So it doesn't really matter how much cash you store someplace secretly. If you can't manage the logistics, you don't know what to do with it. Mm. So if you really want to enforce the use of cash, then you have to have some kind of a legal structure supporting that, because otherwise cash is just going to go away.
I feel very insecure with that cash, but that's just me. Soyoung, when you take a look at the future global financial system, do you see it as being more integrated or more fragmented? The reason I'm asking is because if you take a look at the crypto assets networks, they're kind of like closed loop. So projecting forward, Soyoung, do you think it's going to be more integrated or fragmented?
That'll be more integrating. So we have more and more electronic forms, and also we have more and more crypto assets and many other things. So, yeah.
Mm. What are the risks that it could be more fragmented?
Actually, in general, we probably have to think about there are more and more interconnection between crypto assets and the financial system. So in some cases, this is both in domestic and international. And in some cases, financial firms are directly investing in crypto assets. And in other cases, financial firms make equity investment in crypto asset companies and vice versa. And in fact, in April 2021, Coinbase went public on NASDAQ. This is the first time a crypto asset company has entered in the capital market. And in addition, nowadays, pension funds from major countries also purchase shares of Coinbase. So crypto asset exposure of traditional financial system has expanded. So this has led concerns about liquidity risk and also financial instability. The price of I think the main problem is the price of crypto assets are very volatile. So if these assets are held by financial firms, they can cause large losses when the price drops sharply. And financial firms may use crypto assets as collateral for loans, and they may also extend credit to crypto assets service providers. This can also lead to financial instability if the price of asset plummets. In addition, stable coins can be more deeply connected to the core financial system through reserve assets. And I think to address all these concerns about crypto assets, monitoring and regulation is very important, and that should be led by a very reputable authority, for example, a government. And it's very important for the government to clearly understand the new financial linkages and new systemic risks. So, there are more and more interconnection between crypto assets and financial sectors. So government should keep watching and monitoring. And also the government should recognize that this connection or this risk can change very rapidly. Mm-hmm. And sometimes this change at these connections or risks can evolve in the direction that we are not expected. So government should really carefully monitor the development of the crypto markets.
Right. I think we discussed earlier how the issue of interoperability is key. It is complicated. How is BIS looking at it? How do you expedite it, and what's being done at the BIS Innovation Hub to address the issue?
Well, interoperability is absolutely key. And it's partly about the technology. Let me come back to that later. But I think it's important to underscore the importance of things we can do even without going to the frontier. So if we think about the current financial system, how can we encourage interoperability among all the various participants in the financial system and the economy more generally? I think we've learned that it's the governance and the institutional features which are really crucial for this. So this includes, for example, the data governance standards, all the initiatives on open data, open banking, which levels the playing field, enables entry, enables competition and financial inclusion. I think that's been very well demonstrated to be really crucial for economic efficiency and for well-being generally. And we know from the walled garden set up by the big techs that if we had the ability to channel the network effects in the in the good direction, we can actually do a lot of good. So certainly we can do a lot even with the current system. The other thing that we should be very, very cognizant of is the institutional backdrop. So when the managing director talked about public infrastructure and the IMF's work on the global platform, what that does is to enable lots of different and disparate parties to actually come together and transact. You're not working in a silo where you're beholden to one particular provider. And I think here, it also guides the way that we design digital money. Because if we have a stable coin, what typically happens is that there are exchange rates between stable coins. I mean, they may be very small deviations from par, but there will be an exchange rate. And sometimes these exchange rates can become quite volatile. For example, as we saw at the time of the FTX collapse last November. And what that argues for is that we need something that preserves the singleness of money. And singleness of money means whether you pay using cash or whether you pay using a banking app or a fintech app. $1 is $1. 1,000 won is 1,000 won. And you don't have exchange rates between money. And I think it's absolutely crucial that we have that so that money can play the role of the convention that Stefan mentioned. So the technology obviously features into this because we can design various initiatives where we build in these institutional and governance standards. And the IMF Global Platform is certainly one example of this. But you can also link just existing fast payment systems. So the managing director mentioned Project Nexus, which is the project that comes out of the BIS Singapore Center of the Innovation Hub. And this is nothing revolutionary in terms of the technology. What it does is to link existing fast payment systems so that when I pay someone in another country, I can do it just as if I'm paying domestically and the money shows up immediately. And I think what that shows you is that the technology is very much, of course, secondary here. What's really important is to think about the architecture and the public good nature of money.
And that element of trust, Kristalina.
Mm-hmm. Yep, and the element of trust. But also, it is trust and it is functionality. We want money to store value in a reliable manner and be means of exchange fast and the cheapest, the cheaper the better. I can call this money. If you are willing to exchange things, sure. But it stores some value. However, very impractical. If I decide to build my life on this being my means of exchange, good luck to me. So it is some of what we have learned over thousands of years about means of exchange and storing value. And what now technological advancements can put on a different platform with different speed. It would be reliable only as you brought it back. It would be reliable only if it is on foundation of trust. And foundation of trust comes with rules that are respected by everybody, with legal frameworks that operate, and that there is no shortcut for it.
And David, is that even realistic?
What specifically realistic?
I mean, interoperability, if it's based on trust, if it's...
First off, from a technical perspective, yes, interoperability comes with challenges, especially in the world of distributed ledgers, distributed computing, blockchain, because it's in the perfect world, it's on one ledger. It makes it much more difficult to tamper with and the like, but there has been a lot of work done. So the answer is the technology side is not a long-term challenge. It's a short-term challenge. And then, money and trust and the singleness of money. I read the work that BIS did. I mean, that's very important. one of the things I've always struggled with, and I'm not a monetary person, but we've referred to stable coins as if they're money. I look at them as a poorly regulated money market fund. And that's effectively what they are, and it's just a way for me to get swap in and out of my crypto. That's why they exist. So I mean, for me, I'm, you know, as a traditionalist, I'm just really encourage you know, central banks to kind of get on with it and you know, realize the gaps that need to be filled. Ultimately, you know, trust comes from the full faith and credit of the country that backs it up. And as Stefan said earlier, there's some countries where as sound. But generally speaking, I think the technology is just an enabler to a more efficient global monetary system.
Mm-hmm. We talked about CBDCs, but we also talked about how they are private forms of digital money. Stefan, talk to us about the risks from both the private forms of digital money and CBDCs.
Well, first of all, given that I've sort of come from the central banking side, it has always puzzled me when people say that a CBDC is very risky in some sense, because if you go back to the 1800s when everything was on paper, I know that the Bankers Association in my country argued that when the central bank got the sole right to issue physical banknotes, they would go under. The private banks, they still exist. So apparently they were wrong. And now this whole conversation sort of comes back in a way that I find a hard time, that I have a hard time to understand, because actually central bank money provides stability to the system, not instability, provided that you do this in a sensible way. But we have already talked about and touched on legacy systems and the issues with old legacy payment systems, and they are stable, and maybe they've been too stable because everything is moving somewhere else. And that creates risks in itself, because the fiat money team, as I call it, has actually been a bit too slow on this side. And I liked your example, and I'll give you two other examples where it sort of is not so easy to really understand what we're talking about. And I'm picking, this is not to pick on these particular examples, because there are probably many, many others. When Libra showed up out of the blue some years back, and it never really took off, I asked my staff to get me the tech specs and what it was all about. So we got 150, 200 pages of stuff. And what really surprised me was that in that document, they had only 10 pages on the monetary aspect of Libra. And that told me that these guys didn't really know what they were doing, or they had something to hide. And that made me very, very sort of suspicious of the whole setup. And it was kind of a money market fund, sort of, but you couldn't really get to the legal stuff in a way that made sense, so that you really could understand. Something similar happened to the other day, because I stumbled over the PayPal dollar, which has showed up now. If you go to the internet and try to understand what a PayPal dollar actually is, be my guest. You're gonna have to click pretty far into the system before you find this stuff, what it actually is. And my conclusion is that either it is a money market fund, or it's a bank, or it's some version of both. And in terms of risks and consumer protection, that's not a good place to be, because actually consumers need to understand what they're buying and selling and what they're investing in. So and this is not to pick on these, particularly on these two companies, but this is a sort of a common feature, that you try to sell something to the general public, and the general public can't really fully understand what on earth it is that they're buying. And if you call this thing a stable coin, you sort of take for granted that you will always get your money. You can transact and get your US dollars in that particular case. But if you click your way deep, deep into the system, you actually end up on a page where it says, we can unilaterally impose withdrawal restrictions on you. So much about the moneyness of that particular money. And this is really where we have some issues when it comes to risks, and where the public sector needs to work hand in hand with the private sector, so that you can actually better understand what you are doing.
because an essential feature of a market economy is well understood transfers of ownership titles. And when stuff goes in one direction, money usually goes in the other direction. And if you cannot do that in a legally sound way, you run a pretty high risk that systems will collapse sooner or later. And that's an issue in itself. So technology here can do an awful lot of nice things. That is absolutely a given. But you need to have legal certainty so that you know what you are actually doing. And if that is not the case, if somebody is promising that the sky is the limit, beware, because that is probably not the case. And it's obvious when we think about these things in sort of physical terms that if you're trading stamps, no one would ever claim that trading stamps is equivalent to money. Mm. But when it comes to digital stuff, all of a sudden you claim that something is money when it is not money, when it is actually much closer to trading stamps. Mm. And that's where the risks come from. And as always, when it comes to dealing with the financial sector, try to find the leverage. And if you can pin down where you have too much leverage, then you have also found a risk. But you have always have all sorts of elaborate systems where you try to hide the leverage. And then the whole thing blows up, and then a couple of years later you say, oh my gosh, had I just understood that this whole thing was completely over-levered, everybody would have been better off. And these risks are sort of certainly there when it comes to these new instruments as well.
Help me understand, in the not so distant future, when central banks launch their CBDCs, will they coexist with a private digital money? How will it work?
Yes, it's not harder than that, because we have had that kind of a system for hundreds of at least 150 years when it comes to everything being paper-based. And this is only taking the concepts that evolved over hundreds of years and accepting that technology has changed, but using the same concepts within a digital world.
Kyungho?
I mean, this is exactly the system we have now, where commercial bank deposits are the primary means of payment for most of us, but central bank reserves, so central bank money, is the settlement asset. I mean, that's what gives the interoperability that we talked about. And so in some ways, CBDCs are already here. So, you know, we have central bank money in digital form. I think we can quibble about what exactly, you know, what additional features we would like CBDCs to take on. But to a large extent, we already have it here. And I think this is where we need to use the private sector's ingenuity and creativity to actually provide the customer-facing services. But the central banks and the public authorities, they can provide the infrastructure.
Mm-hmm. Where do you see the collaboration, Kristalina?
Well, the collaboration between private sector innovators and public authorities, it is happening. What we do here is collaboration between private sector and public authorities. And what we have seen is that, indeed, the private sector brings more creativity, more innovation, but actually the credible private sector begs for the public sector to play its role. And it is, what is the legal framework? What are the rules? What are the standards? And Stefan brought a point that we should not forget. How is this all being supervised in this new era? What is the role of supervising authorities? We also look for our role as an international financial institution, and it is to bring different experiences together, help countries learn from each other, and then help those that are with more limited institutional capabilities not to fall behind. We have an instrument called FSAP, Financial Sector Assessment
And that instrument today has to reflect the changing nature of money, the fact that we have CBDCs, interest, actually not just interest. We now have 19 countries where CBDCs are reality. Mm. And we have a universe of at least 60 where progress is being made. They're not just exploring, they're working on it. To those that are saying, well, I don't know where the CBDC is for us, and we know that in some economies that is being questioned, my advice is stay on top of it because you don't want to be falling behind just because you are not engaged, not on top of it. In the world we are, where change is happening much more rapidly than it used to happen. In the 19th century, well, you know, we moved around on buggies with horses. We just have to have both public institutions much more interested in developments and engaged in the bodies that they have to help them. But also private entrepreneurs being more open to collaborate with the public sector, because what if I put a very simplistic view, when we talk about CBDCs, the issue of interoperability is absolutely paramount. We cannot be in a world where every country has its own money and they don't talk to others, whereas in the world of stable coins, the regulation is the paramount priority. There has to be clarity of how this all works. And these two topics, interoperability and regulation, they cannot be addressed without partnership between public and private sector. We are just not going, I mean, Stefan talked about it, we cannot get to fast enough to the point that serves the public if we choose to go our own way, not talk with each other, not engage with each other.
Yeah, go ahead.
Let me briefly add on the international cooperation, the importance of the international cooperation. So currently, international organizations make recommendations on crypto asset regulation. And they also provide the direction for discussions in order to apply common standards. And I think all these efforts are very important. And then each country does not have the same situation. So there will be differences when detailed regulations are applied. Then we can share and learn from each country's experience. And this helps create a better crypto asset ecosystem. And I think this is exactly the purpose of this conference. And when Korea prepares laws on crypto assets, we also met with major institutions like U.S. regulators and IMF, and we discussed regulation trends and policy directions. And we are also checking with other international organizations like FSP and IOSCO, and we will continue our efforts in this direction. And FSB and IOSCO also both says that the sharing information is very important, and cooperating with the other authorities are very important. So Korean government will also share the information with other jurisdictions to ensure coordinated policy responses. And we will also actively participate in the efforts of international organizations to establish regulatory standards. Mm-hmm.
Just a couple of minutes left. I just want to go down the line, maybe a call to action as we head towards digital money.
I think, let me just underline what the managing director said. The private sector is incredibly creative, and you have a lot of ingenuity in providing customer-facing services. I think the issue, if you just leave it to the private sector, is that they tend to achieve the aims by you know, whatever means available. So you can build silos. Many commercial banks have tokenization initiatives. It's all within the silo. And they would use stable coins because, you know, that is the simplest payment instrument. I think there is a very, very important role for the official sector, very important role for central banks in providing a firm foundation upon which others can build. And I think that's the way where we can make the progress in the fastest way.
David?
Really quickly, the only thing I would say is the private sector can be very self-serving at times, mm-hmm. and you all are supposed to rise above that. The last thought I would have is embrace the change. All the work we're doing and moving towards production supports a two-tier monetary model that will be very familiar. But we just have the advantages that the ledger can bring, which is smart money. It's easier to have regulatory oversight to understand and see flows in real time and to enhance your economy and help your businesses in many of the ways I've already discussed. So embrace change and be not afraid, I suppose.
So. Be bold. So yeah. Young?
You cannot turn back time, because mm-hmm. if that had been the case, the institution I happen to represent would have been in favor of 20 kilo copper coins. And then we would not have existed. So you just have to accept change. Having said that, it's incredibly important to do this jointly with the private sector mm-hmm. and in such a way that you have a legal framework supporting what you do. Because that's the only way to define who owns what, when, and why. And that's what you need in a functioning market economy.
Kristalina.
Well, keep an open mind and embrace opportunities, manage the risks responsibly. Time is not our friend. We have to move fast. So my last word is, buckle up.
Wise words. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in thanking our panelists today. Thank you.
And to our lovely moderator as well, thank you for the great timekeeping and the moderation. Thank you very much. Please give him another big round of applause. Thank you very much. And now, ladies and gentlemen, I believe that we have deserved a good coffee break. We will now break for 20 minutes and resume later on. We do have coffee and refreshments and snacks in the lobby, so please do enjoy, and I will see you back here in 20 minutes. Thank you.